Islamic Pulse has received numerous questions from the believers regarding the Lady of Heaven movie. Due to be released in 2021, the film depicts a story of an Iraqi child who has lost his mother in a country torn apart by ISIS. In parallel, the movie will depict the historical narrative of Lady Fatima sallallahu alayha, the blessed daughter of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Seeing the apparently phenomenal cinematography, you might be wowed by the trailer and think, finally, the narrative of the tragic events after the demise of the Holy Prophet are going to be portrayed. This can only be a good thing, right? Wrong. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, two things have broken my back, the sinful scholar and the ignorant one who pretends to worship. We must be careful that we do not belong to one of the two groups that broke Imam Ali alayhi salam's back while thinking that we love him. Now, before we go into the film, let's discuss the jubilant writer of the film, Yasir Habib. This is the man who has tainted the pulpit of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi with his foul, disingenuous, and frankly disgusting words. He has referred to Aisha, the wife of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, as a promiscuous woman.
هي امرأة خسيسة. هي لما خرجت ضد أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام الرجال كانوا يطوفون عليها. فوتين وبيع. إلى درجة يتبركون بخرء جمل تركبه. هذا بعد خرء الجمل لو محصلين خرء ما لها شي يسوون.
This is foul for anyone who loves the Holy Prophet, whether Shia or Sunni. He even tries to show that our noble prophet beat his wife Aisha.
بسبب بشاعة فعل عائشة ها هنا لم يتحمل واضطر لأن يضربها تأديبا لا ضربة خفيفة وإنما ضربة أوجعتها.
He has said that Umar, the second caliph, was a passive homosexual.
عمر بن الخطاب مثلا الذي تسمى بهذا الاسم ورضي به كان لا ريب منكوح.
They're so childish that they even try and state that the caliphs were ugly.
That Umar ibn al-Khattab was a very ugly person.
Him and his goons celebrate the death anniversary of the revered Sunni personalities. The rhetoric of Yasir Habib is clearly crafted solely for the purpose of hurting the sentiments of Muslims. All these foul things are based on ahadith, which are massively contentious from obscure sources, and many Muslims, Shia and Sunni scholars do not believe them to be authentic. Anyone who dives into the ocean of ahadith is bound to find all kinds of obscure, bizarre, even un-Islamic narrations. Our history is full of personalities who were liars or hypocrites or others who were not even Muslim, or others who wished to bring ill repute to the religion of Islam, who hated the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the Ahlul Bayt and the companions. They wanted to slur the personalities, and many of these such individuals narrated ahadith. Thus, throughout our history, we have a plethora of fallacious, twisted, and dirty ahadith. It is the job of the noble scholars of today to filter through the dirt in order to arrive at the true pearls and gems of wisdom and truth. But if a scholar digs up such obscure, controversial, and damning narrations and presents them as facts, does it help the Muslims? Remember when Netflix released the Messiah TV series? It was clear that this was an attack on the sacred personality of the Mahdi and an affront to the divine concept of Mahdawiyya. Only the silliest Muslims would have said, "Oh, how wonderful, this is our narrative being shown." The Lady of Heaven movie is more dangerous than that, because while the former was an obvious attack, the latter is so cleverly crafted that the believers can easily be deceived by it. This film is undoubtedly designed to create fitna. The film is evidently designed to anger Sunnis and make them hate Shias. It is their respected caliphs and companions who are villainized by the movie. And also, the film is designed to anger Muslims generally. How? They depict the holy personalities. On their website, they state, in accordance with Islamic tradition, how courteous of you, during the making of this film, no individual represented the holy personality. What are you talking about? It doesn't matter in the slightest if the performances of the holy personalities were achieved through visual effects, because whether through an actor or any other medium, if the faces of those personalities are depicted, it hurts the sentiments of Muslims. Evermore, it shall be known that Shias were the ones to do this. The Holy Quran states, fitna is worse than killing. Why? Because if a murderer kills someone, he kills someone. But if a foul individual creates fitna, discord, animosity, hatred, it kills millions. ISIS only murders people. But the fitna of British Shiaism creates more ISIS. Just after the release of this trailer, 11 more Shia Hazaras were massacred. And you might say, well, they've been killing Shias throughout history. What a silly argument. The fire is burning, so we might as well fan the flames even more while sitting in the UK. We should not be surprised if there is a resurgence of ISIS in the world after this $15 million budget British movie, due to the amount of animosity and hatred it is bound to create. And as soon as the trailer comes out, guess who jumps on the bandwagon showing his full support? Ammar Naqshbandi.
Why is it of the utmost importance that we finally have a film about the life of Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam? The film is important because for once the Shi'i conception of Fatima emerges. I'm fully supportive of someone discussing history.
Furthermore, he ridicules those who raise objections and wish to critically examine the intentions, motives, and institutions behind the making of this film. Everyone who has a problem with the film is either a wacky conspiracy theorist who believes that the MI5 and MI6 are behind it.
For love of God, try and be a bit more mature about these issues. Anything that a person disagrees with, MI5, MI6.
Or those who have an issue with the film deny history.
There are some Shia who, when this film came out, you know what they were saying? Why are you talking about people who were close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? How dare you speak about them? You shouldn't speak about them. And also, how do we know that all of this took place?
Let me make this very clear. We are not against the narrating of true and accurate history. But there is a way to do it. A good example, in fact, would be Brother Khalid Jafar's Orthodox Islam series. You'll notice that he addresses all the major points of disagreement in a way that is inviting, logical, and not aimed at bashing, insulting, or hurting anyone. Iran also commemorates Ayyam-e Fatimiyya every year. Imam Khamenei himself attends the majalis of Sayyida Zahra, salamullah alayha. In fact, he hosts those majalis in Tehran, in Bayt-e Rahbari. This is not about denying elements of history. This is about using history to create fitna, which is precisely what this movie is doing. He is attempting to make his audience think that those who dislike the movie deny history. But by his own admission, he knows very well that the film will cause sectarian tension.
It's gonna cause sectarian tension. You must have heard this line. That if a film like this, The Lady of Heaven, comes out, it will cause sectarian tension. Can I deny that it will cause sectarian tension? I can't deny.
But he just doesn't care. It is precisely this careless and irresponsible behavior which has devastating results.
I'm very proud of this brilliant, high-quality cinematic production.
This is a clear fitna, and Naqshbandi has not only brazenly put his rubber stamp of approval on it, but the funniest thing is, after endorsing the movie, Naqshbandi tries to cover himself.
I've not seen the film, but as long as the intention is a pure intention, and the narrative isn't one which brings condescending language. That's one thing I hope for.
Isn't it funny that someone who, with such lackluster, memorizes speeches and regurgitates them from the pulpit, suddenly forgets what Yasir Habib is all about and all the foul things that he says? Does Naqshbandi really lack knowledge of contemporary history and individuals like Yasir Habib? Of course not. So why is he playing with people's minds and emotions? He even goes a step further, actually promoting the idea that Muslims should overlook Yasir Habib's flaws. It's what is being said that should be looked at, not who is saying it, right?
But do I support this film or not? Especially if the people behind the film are people who I may not necessarily agree with all their opinions. Because, you know, in the Muslim community, we do sometimes have this issue where we don't look at who's speaking. What we do is we don't look at what they're saying, we look at who's speaking. Isn't that true?
Any lay person who hears it will think, yeah, that makes sense. Doesn't matter who is saying it. But it's not that simple. If the scholars themselves are corrupt, it will inevitably corrupt the understanding of the masses. This may be why Imam Kadhim alayhi salam said, knowledge can only be gained from a godly scholar, and recognition of that scholar is through the intellect. It is absolutely important in today's time of fitna and confusion to use our intellects to differentiate between those who are the true godly pious scholars those who are just in it for themselves. This is British Shiaism, an ideology which works for the British and American interests, and which is being funded in the millions, if not billions of dollars. Fadak TV is one of their platforms, with Yasser Habib directly behind it. But the Shirazis have a number of media platforms churning out this divisive hate speech. These platforms use the name of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam to defame the noble school of Ahlul Bayt. One of these channels is Imam Hussein TV, where Naqshbandi is given a platform. Now it should make perfect sense why he so boldly says,
"Because we live in a world where the media is free."
But now I live in a time where there's no way someone can put a gun to my head and dictate to me.
Hey, it ain't your head we're worried about, trust me. It's the people of Islamic countries that will suffer, not you. And if you do agree with Naqshbandi, I wonder, which Naqshbandi do you agree with? Do you agree with the Naqshbandi now, or the Naqshbandi that existed back in 2012? Because that Naqshbandi seemed to understand.
Know that disunity is the virus in our community. For example, us, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we have a couple of Mawlanas on YouTube. One wears a white turban, the other wears a black turban. You find them on YouTube attacking the companions of Rasulullah publicly, cursing with the filthiest language. And the problem is, when a person looks at this on YouTube, he doesn't know the difference between who's really a scholar and who's not. You look and all you see is someone who looks like a Mawlana or a teacher or a scholar of the school of Ahlul Bayt, giving the filthiest language with the filthiest rhetoric.
And they were now the henchmen for the first Khalifa, Gaddafi or Saddam, for example. If they have someone who doesn't pledge allegiance to them, we used to all speak out against them, didn't we? All of us used to say, these dictators of Islam. Why then a rule for Saddam and Gaddafi and not a rule for the terrorist government at the beginning of the religion of Islam, yes?
And you find that instead of people speaking out against them, but you know, he's a Mawlana and I can't really say anything. The moment you see a Mawlana sit on the member of Al Muhammad who's causing disunity between Muslims, pull him off. Pull him off!
The best description in terms of physical appearance would be that when Umar would walk on one side of the road, Shaytan would go on the other. Yep. A woman would miscarry her baby when pregnant when she saw Umar ibn Khattab's face. So that should give you enough of an indication as to his physical appearance.
Don't let a person like this stay! Do you know how many lives we lost in Pakistan because of Mawlanas who would come and speak filthily about others and people innocently got killed? The best doctors of the community got killed. The best intellectuals got killed. Why? Because that person doesn't think of the Muslim Ummah, he thinks of himself. Am I entertaining my crowd? Are they showing me entertainment back? Then yes, then I'll continue. Think about those brothers in Saudi Arabia who don't know how to get home because of your lecture. Think of those brothers in Pakistan who get beheaded because of your lecture. When Ali ibn Abi Talib brought this message, he said, remove your differences and strengthen your ties. Not strengthen your differences and remove your ties. Ali ibn Abi Talib is dying and he's saying, remove your differences and strengthen your ties as Muslims. And we have people who claim to be followers of Al Muhammad. The moment you see a Mawlana sit on the member of Al Muhammad who's causing disunity between Muslims, pull him off. Pull him off! Pull him off! Pull him off!
Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, the one amongst people to be the most severely punished will be the scholar who has not benefited from his knowledge one bit. One of the blatant narratives being pushed by British Shiaism is that Sunnis, Sunni figures, Sunni books are the cause of ISIS.
ISIS, when they burned that munafiq, where do you think ISIS got the permission to burn that munafiq? The permission that came was what? The permission that came was because Abu Bakr ordered that those hypocrites who go against him are burnt. Someone who is a terrorist is someone who does not mind coming to your house and threatening to burn you in the house, yes? When Umar ibn al-Khattab makes it clear, let's burn the house of Fatima.
This time Naqshbandi has even gone a step further in comparing Abu Bakr and Umar as those who oppress children in the Middle East.
You talk about when a Muslim child in the Middle East, people pelt him with stones or burn their houses, you talk openly about that. And how all of us should campaign for those innocent children who are being oppressed. But the first innocent child who was oppressed, all of us remain silent on?
And yes, this is absolutely an insult to them. This is absolutely abusing them. I don't know how you can call somebody ISIS and then go, I'm not insulting you, I'm just calling you ISIS. This is a far worse form of insult. Rather than helping Muslims to stick together and defend one another, it's actually pushing the Shias to say, not me, I'm Shia. It's the Sunnis who are the problem. Ayatollah Sistani said, Shias should defend Sunnis' social and political rights before defending their own rights. And we call everyone for unity. It is the social and political right of the Sunnis to follow their khalifs. Branding those khalifs and revered figures as terrorists is a lowly, cowardly, and sectarian approach which causes disunity among the Muslim Ummah. And the film is chiming precisely those same sentiments. Don't worry, little orphan boy who will command the sympathy of the audience. You'll be able to fight back against ISIS, just like Fatima salamullah alayha fought back against who? Umar. And they actually want to show that mainstream Sunniism is the issue.
And do you know where most of these people who are fighting for ISIS, you know where they're coming from, most of them? Sudan, Chechnya, Bosnia, bottom line, Ahlus Sunnah.
And it is tiring to hear people coming and saying, oh, why are you compromising on Shia-Shia unity for the sake of those Sunnis? Why are you condemning Ammar Naqshbandi and Yasir Habib? They're Shias. Are you telling me that anybody who puts on a turban, anybody who claims to follow the Ahlul Bayt, suddenly becomes untouchable, even if they commit every sin under the sky and start misleading the Ummah? In fact, forget about being Shia, you have to be Muslim first. Ayatollah Bahjat said, one who does not wish for the unity of Muslims is not a Muslim. The Quran itself tells us, and hold firmly to the rope of Allah all together and do not become divided. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, a Muslim is the brother of a fellow Muslim. He neither wrongs him nor insults him. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, a Muslim is he whose hand and tongue people feel safe from. Do fellow Muslims feel safe from the tongues of such individuals? They call themselves Shias, they call themselves Muslims, but their actions reveal the contrary. And now it is becoming absolutely clear why the Waliul Faqih, the leader, Imam Sayyid Ali Khamenei said, we do not accept the Shiaism whose propagation is based and headquartered in London. This is not the Shiaism which the Imams alayhim as-salam promoted and wanted. A Shiaism which is based upon creating differences, based upon preparing and clearing the way for the presence of the enemies of Islam. This Shiaism is not Shiaism, it is deviance. Are they Shia? Well, there's types of Shias. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, our Shia are of three types. One type trick people in our name. Another type are like glass, which discloses everything that is inside. They cannot keep hidden that which is placed in their trust like secrets. And one type are like red gold, which the more it is brandished in the fire, the purer it becomes. There are many who claim to be Shias. You tell me, are they not tricking people in the name of the Ahlul Bayt? Are they not like transparent vessels that can't keep their mouths shut about certain issues? Whatever dirt they dig up, there's no examination, there's no consideration of the modern context in which we live. There is absolutely no consideration of the fact that Islam is being attacked as a whole by the imperialists and Zionists. No, they go onto the pulpit only to share divisive statements and to share sectarian filth. To be Shia in today's time means to follow the honorable Marjas, and all of them have been urging for unity. Look at the desperation of Ayatollah Sistani in his plea for unity. Everyone realizes the desperate need for unity and for renouncing divisions, avoiding sectarian fanaticism, and avoiding arousing sectarian disputes. And by the way, this film is not something new. Similar efforts have been made in the past. Ayatollah Makarem has stated in regards to a previous effort of British Shiaism, without doubt, those who helped to produce and release this film, as well as those who watch it, have committed a mortal sin. It is quite likely that the enemies of Islam have a hand in all of this, and they have planned to incite a lot of bloodshed among the Muslims through this film. Therefore, all those who help in the production of this film will also be responsible for any Muslim blood that is spilled on its account. Grand Ayatollah Nasser Makarem, Ayatollah Hussein Nouri Hamadani, Ayatollah Ja'far Subhani, Ayatollah Lutfullah Gulpaygani, all of them have banned any aids made to Yasser Habib's Fadak TV. This is the overall sentiment of the Honorable Marjaz collectively to prioritize the unity of Muslims, Sunni and Shia. But just look at how Naqshbandi attempts to diminish the role of our Honorable Marjaz.
If my Marja allows, then I'm gonna watch. And if my Marja says, no, don't watch a film about the martyrdom of Fatima, then I will listen to the advice of my Marja.
As long as your Marja doesn't say anything, just ignore it. Others are completely irrelevant.
And if you follow the Marja, follow him. Follow your Marja then.
Let's look at the Marjas a moment as pious, God-fearing scholars who have studied Islam for 50, 60, 70, 80 years. This knowledgeable contemporary scholar has expressed his expert opinion on a matter which concerns everyone. It makes absolutely no sense to just ignore and disregard it. But Naqshbandi says, it's not your Marja who said it, so just ignore it. Irrelevant. Why? Because Naqshbandi wants Islam to become a matter of mere opinions and views. This Marja has a vision, and so do I. You can choose which opinion you like.
Your Marja gives you a vision, gives you advice. You can follow what he says, or if you follow somebody else, there are other Maraja. Maybe this Marja in his own vision, he believes, and you could see where they're coming from, that maybe there can be tension.
This is not Shiaism, and this is not Islam. Islam teaches us to follow the experts in any given field. The Marjas are the experts in fiqh and in Islam, not Naqshbandi. But he wishes for their wise, weighty, and trustworthy verdicts to come down to the same base level as his in the eyes of his audience. Just compare the Naqshbandi that we had before to the Naqshbandi we have today.
You look and all you see is someone who looks like a Mawlana or a teacher or a scholar of the school of Ahlul Bayt giving the filthiest language with the filthiest rhetoric. Sayyid Ali Khamenei spoke out against them. Sayyid Ali Sistani spoke out against them. Did they listen? No. They come back and reply, if our Marja speaks out, we will stop.
I will listen to the advice of my Marja. At the end of the day, when someone keeps forwarding messages everywhere that Marja has said, you should not watch, why are you suddenly quoting from a Marja now who you hardly ever quote from?
Sayyid Ali Khamenei spoke out against them. Sayyid Ali Sistani spoke out against them. Did they listen? No. They come back and reply, if our Marja speaks out, we will stop. But considering our Marja and Qom hasn't spoken out, we'll continue with this filthy language. I tell you, is this what the school of Ahlul Bayt wanted?
You do his taqlid, I can refer to my Marja as well.
Who is your Marja then? Which so-called Marja calls for disunity and for highlighting historical differences and fanning the flames of sectarianism? The only so-called Marja that doesn't call for unity and refers to it as a scam is he who must not be named, Sadiq Shirazi. Look at how Naqshbandi defends him and ridicules the notion that he is problematic.
I've seen people who say, you know, this Shirazi, Ayatollah Shirazi, MI6, MI5, CIA. If he is all of those, how is he coaching in Qom so comfortably?
Sadiq Shirazi is a shut-in. He is not to go out in public for political mass gatherings. What else do you want Iran to do? Execute him? The moment Iran does that, these very same hypocrites will jump up and down and say, look, Iran is against freedom of speech. They killed our Marja. And if Iran were to extradite him, Sadiq Shirazi would get a first-class ticket to London so that he can cheerlead the British Shiaism fitna. You know why they put all the Marjas aside and follow this so-called Marja? You know why the likes of Naqshbandi seek to downplay and mitigate the role of Marja'iyya when it comes to issues like unity and this film? Because the British authorities know that Marja'iyya today is the biggest strength and power of the Muslim world. Through the Marja's tobacco ban, we defeated the British in Iran. And through the Marja's call for unity, we crushed ISIS in Iraq. Alhamdulillah. And thus it is the British authority that wishes to undermine Marja'iyya. This is far bigger than Yasir Habib and Naqshbandi. They are puppets, knowingly or unknowingly. And the British will replace them the moment they've outdone their usefulness to them. And the British authorities are the kings of fitna. Who can deny it? Divide and rule is their motto. It's the British who created Takfiri Wahhabism in the first place. It's the British who support the Saudis today. It's the British who fully support the tyrannical kings of Bahrain and the UAE. Did you know that the biggest mosque in the UK is a £15 million project? Is it Sunni? Is it Shia? No! It's Ahmadiyya, those who follow a false messianic figure and Dajjal, another deviated sect created by none other than the British. The same Taghut which knighted Salman Rushdie, who openly insulted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi, his wives, and enraged Muslims globally by writing satanic verses. Would anyone be surprised if the adherents of British Shiaism are one day knighted by the Queen? Naqshbandi is probably getting thrills just thinking about it. Sir Dr. Sayyid Ammar Naqshbandi? He doesn't even see why it would be a total travesty. They don't understand why it is problematic in Islam, while the Quran says, "Have you not seen those who claim to believe in what was revealed to you and what was revealed before you? They wish to refer legislation to the Taghut, while they were commanded to reject it, and Satan wishes to lead them far astray." The fact that Naqshbandi openly supported Biden in America is not a secret. Here he is on a live online call with the criminal John Kerry, who boastfully participated in the Vietnam War, where hundreds of thousands of innocent Vietnamese were butchered by America. And it has been stated that Naqshbandi serves as the special representative to the United Nations for the Universal Muslim Association of America. Umar, remember, Paul Wolfowitz was the first keynote speaker at the first event of Umar, the same man who has been described as the architect of the Iraq War, and the first thing Umar does is give their full, unconditional support to the Bush administration for the illegal invasion of Iraq, leading to the genocide and destruction of the lives of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Muslims, Sunni and Shia. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, "Cursed, cursed indeed is the scholar who frequents an unjust ruler, aiding him in his injustice." Yasir Habib is a known, clear and obvious deviant. Ammar Naqshbandi has attacked the core fundamental Islamic principle of unity. He has endorsed a film which is a clear example of fitna. He has shown his support for the likes of Yasir Habib. He is strategically going against the guidance of the honorable marjas of today. He has revealed his siding with Sadiq Shirazi. He has spread doubts about the divine concept of Wilayatul Faqih. He has openly gone against the stance of the leader, Waliul Faqih, Imam Khamenei. He is unashamedly serving the interests of the Taghut, and he is a clear example of British Shiaism. If you still feel like him and others like him are a good thing, then they are not the problem. You are. And you have weak iman and weak faith. Imam Askari alayhi salam said in his description of evil scholars, "They cause more harm to the weak ones from among our Shia than the army of Yazid did to Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his companions. For they snatched away their lives and their properties, whereas these evil scholars enter doubt and obscurity into the weak ones from among our Shia and lead them astray." Do not let them enter any doubts or obscurities into your hearts or the hearts of your loved ones. British Shiaism is real. And yes, it is a generalization. Remember, the people of Kufa, while claiming to be Shia, betrayed Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Today, London has become the same. They claim to follow the Mahdi, but they are generally traitors to the cause of Wilaya. I was born and raised in the UK myself. I've met these individuals, I've worked with many of them. They're actually one of the contributing factors to why I left the UK in the first place. They are manipulating the reality of Shiaism, and they are creating a new deviant sect which people will think is Shiaism when it's not. And they have harmed the cause of Fatima salamullah alayha by using her sacred name to advance the cause of her enemies today.
The ultimate cause of Islam is to establish a world of justice, peace, and tolerance across the planet under the rulership of the divinely appointed Wali, i.e. Wilaya. Wilaya is what Fatima Salamullah alayha stood for. It is for the cause of Wilaya that she went from door to door to gather help and support for. And it is for Wilaya that she became Shaheed. If only you understood.